Thank you very much, Brian, and thank you all for coming here. This is the beginning of 99 Seconds, and I want to begin by thanking my co-conspirator, Roger Addison, who helped me put these things together. This is one of those sessions where there are more presenters than members of the audience. And the first ever 99 Seconds started on 1984 when we had Diane Dorment as the vice president, and she said, let's try something new. So we came up with the idea based on the empirically validated fact that in any given situation and in any given presentation session, if you're lucky, you get 99 seconds worth of good stuff. The rest is pure filling. So we thought, if we have everybody just do a 99 second presentation, we can save a lot of unnecessary hassle. There were many people who, when we suggested that, said, this won't play, because here are many metacognitive reasons why this is a futile exercise. But it became one of the most popular activities. However, if you are a presenter, this is one of the most painful things for you to prepare. And as the great Hindu philosopher Mark Twain said, you want me to do a 2-day workshop? I'm ready. You want me to do a 90-minute presentation? Give me 3 minutes. You want to do a 99-second presentation? It's going to take me a long, long time to reduce it to a succinct statement. So, could you all please join me in giving a round of applause for the masochistic presenters who are all lined up here. In case you don't know, 99 Seconds is online. Go to www.ispi.org. You can see 99 Seconds online. And just to refresh these highly anxious presenters exactly what is going to happen, I want to reassure them we have started a new, compassionate, kinder 99 Seconds scheme. For all of you historians, that used to be at the end of 99 Seconds, the present presenter is gonged by the next presenter. So this year there are no gongs, we are gone high-tech, 99 seconds will be counting down. Keep your peripheral vision focused. When it is red, it is too late. So speed up. And here is the procedure. When a previous speaker is talking, the next speaker goes, sits near the laptop computer, getting ready, centering herself or himself, taking deep breaths, telling herself, this is going to be a cinch, no problem. And reassuring herself, if I'm going to make a fool of myself, thank God, at the end of 99 seconds, it's coming to an end. So this is no complete permanent damage. Just today, just for this 99 seconds session, I'm able to invite, to kick off this session, a person, an alien, who has been living amidst us, pretending to be a human performance technologies. So we have great pleasure in presenting to you some highly out of the world, objective observations and advice from Princess Ajwan from a planet far, far away. In my observation of human life forms, I became aware of the fact that people who are called ISPA members have the chip on shoulder approach, which says, give me the data behind everything you say. As a shrewd observer, the princess, hey, calm down. The princess has been willing to suggest to us that we willfully suspend our disbelief. We do not have to have the data to back up anything and everything we do. So just for today, pretend to be a normal human being and give up this challenging attitude. This is a very efficient language. She says, in addition to the data business, there is this notion that as a participant, you got to come sit down and constantly ask yourself, what is in it for me? You have been trained to think, if it is not for you, there is something wrong with the presenter. Where the princess comes from, there is an ancient saying that now is now. This is for you. And if you find it is not applicable to you, in the famous words of B.F. Skinner, it is all your fault. So if you think the thing is not applicable to you, ask yourself, how can I take that and adjust it to meet my needs?
Isto a saka wow. I'm saying, I think we're out of time, so we should stop.
Thank you very much.
Hi, my name is Kevin Eikenberry. Take 1 second to think about what you've invested to get here this week. The time, the money, whether it's your money or your organization's money, take a minute just to think about that investment. What I want to do for the next 89 seconds is talk to you about how you can get more for that investment. The first thing I want you to do before 8:30 tomorrow morning is set some goals. What do you want to accomplish over the next few days? Write those goals down and then let those goals be your guide. All of you have a booklet that talks about all of the many opportunities you have over the next few days. Have a plan. Write your plan down. Decide what you're going to do when. Third, find someone to go to lunch with. If you eat lunch by yourself this week, you're making a mistake. Maybe there's someone you'd really like to meet. Invite them. They'll probably go with you. Fourth, network. Take every opportunity you can to network with the people that sit beside you before a session, in the hallway, and that sort of thing. Five, take some notes. Most important, take some action steps. Daryl Sink's going to tell you a little bit more about how to take care of those action steps later, but get an idea, write them down after each session. Next, have some fun. Let serendipity be your guide. Maybe you change your plan at the last minute. That's okay. Six, get some sleep. Maybe it's seven. I don't know. Get some sleep. You may have trouble balancing this have fun and getting sleep thing, but do it. And lastly, two things when you get home or on your way home. Number one, review what you've learned. Think about it and start to sort it out and review it several times over the next week. And lastly, take a chance to send some thank you notes to those that you learned from this week. Thanks.
Active 99-second session. I want everybody to make a kissing noise. Like, very nice. There was a little performance problem that a high school had. Every time the girls would go into the girls' room and put on their lipstick, they would put a lip imprint on the mirror, like that. And they tried to persuade them not to do this. They had some sessions in a large group and tried to get them to stop this. Finally, the principal gathered all the girls into the girls' room, and said, look, this is a real problem. Every day the custodian has to clean this. In fact, let me show you what the custodian has to do in order to clean this. The custodian came out, Mr. Smith, dipped the squeegee into the toilet and cleaned the mirror. And for some strange reason, they stopped doing that. So what I want you to do is turn to a partner, and from a human performance technology point of view, tell your partner the lesson that this story shows. On your mark, get set, go. Well, I don't know what you got, but a lot of people would say something like, it's a good idea to use a motivational intervention for a motivational problem. And I thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Diane Gajewski, and I have one question for you. If we're so smart, why aren't we rich? We're all here at this conference, and we know a lot about human performance technology. There's a lot of data to back up our methodology, and I think we're all really anxious to employ the methods that we're learning, but the research shows that we have a very hard time implementing these new practices. Thanks to ISPI, I had a small grant, we could use some more support, to try to find out what are some of the barriers to implementing things. And we came up with a couple. One is language. We don't really speak the language of business. Partly is professional stance. Often when something really works, we're secretive about it rather than sharing our success with others. A third thing is our professional openness or professional stance of being reactive rather than proactive. Many of us wait for clients to come to us and tell us what they want rather than going out and uncovering some of the performance problems. And organizational change often derails where we're going. Often there's a change in management, we're headed down a particular path, and then all of a sudden it backfires. But acquire business literacy, be able to look at financial statements, get some outside recognition, get an article published, send your executives notes and articles, make an appointment, take an executive to lunch tomorrow or next week, collaborate with your counterparts in human resources, communication, IT, look on change as challenges and an opportunity to get HPT established, and finally, possibly change your organizational home base. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Lori Gillespie, and I don't have a handout, so don't look for it. But I need everybody to stand up. How many of you have a good sense of balance? I don't see very many hands. How many of you would like to improve your sense of balance? We're going to try to do that today. How many of you think you can improve your sense of balance? Not very many. Let's try this. Everybody, put your feet a little farther apart. Center yourself over them. Okay, now try something. Lift one foot. What happens? Yeah, you fall over. So one of the first things that you need to learn about balance is finding where your center of balance is, so that when your legs are apart, it's through the between your legs to the ground. If you need to get to one leg, you have to move to the one leg that you're going to balance on. So lean to the right or the left and balance on your leg. So that's the knowledge transfer part of it. Now we're going to try the practice part of it. I want everyone to balance on your right leg and lift your left leg and hold it. Yeah. You might want to find your neighbor's shoulder. Excellent. Excellent. How are you doing? Yeah. All right. Practice this every day. Now on the left side.
Okay, I'm Mickey Lane, and I'd like to talk to you about subject matter experts. How many of you work with subject matter experts? Yeah, a lot of us do work with subject matter experts. One of the things that I've found with working with subject matter experts is that when you ask them what a new performer needs to know how to do in order to do their job effectively, they'll start to tell you everything they ever learned in their whole life. Now, somehow we have to pare that back a little bit because we're not going to be able to include that in all the intervention. And one of the tools that we use is something called, with apologies to Keanu Reeves, the Matrix. And in the Matrix, we ask one question, one very straightforward question. If we do not include this material, this content in that intervention, what is the chance that the learner or the performer is going to make an error? And if they do, what are the consequences of that error? Is it going to be tough for them? Is it going to be tough for the organization? If you find that both of these are high, then you better include that topic or that content in the intervention. If one is high and one is low, you make the decisions as to whether or not it's going to be critical. If they happen to be both low, in other words, if no chance for error or very minimal chance for error, and the consequence of that error is very low, this is a good opportunity to take some content out of the intervention. Now, that is, of course, unless you've got some regulatory or certification issues, you better include that in as well. We found by using this matrix, we've been able to drop out between 35 and 40% of the content that the subject matter expert originally said was critical for that intervention. Thank you.
My name is Ogden Lindsley, and we're going to sing my presentation to the tune of Jingle Bells. The words are on your handout. They're also on the overhead. So here we go. How does performance grow as we chart it day by day? To change it, we must know. To forecast, we must say. Multiply, multiply, multiply each week. That's how our performance grows to the fluency we seek. Start with zero. No! To that there's no debate. We must have one to grow. To two, then four, then eight. Multiply, multiply, multiply each week. That's how our performance grows to the fluency we seek. Do errors go away when corrects go up each day? It's not as you think. They go their own way. Multiply, multiply, multiply each week. That's how our performance grows to the fluency we seek. Our middle guide us 10, a middle day 50, and the lowest day is 10. Will top day be 90? No, top 250. Multiply, multiply, multiply each week. That's how our performance grows to the fluency we seek. Middle guide us 10, and a bottom guide us 2. Will top guy do 18? No, top guy does 50. Multiply, multiply, multiply each week. That's how our performance grows to the fluency we seek. Thank you.
I've had to edit my material because the cute little CEO is 14. The handout, which is available, a few in the back and others, if you ask me for one, is unexpurgated. And so if you're interested, go ahead. For about 30 years, I've been doing presentations and writing for this august body, and I've had to leave out a lot of lines. And so in this interactive presentation, your line is, and another thing, and my line is, the point that I left out all those years ago. First, let me hear it. Distance learning, for the most part, isn't. One size never fits all. Self-esteem does not build performance competence. But performance competence does a hell of a lot for self-esteem. Okay, I think we'll periodically go with that when I signal you. I'm a little tired of hearing you. As you are of me. 87.3% of ISPI members talk about reading Tom Gilbert. Studies show 3.78 have actually read Tom Gilbert. Worry about your own damn cholesterol. Multimedia ain't magic, folks. It's a simulation design decision. Technology, all of it, is merely an electronic screwdriver. The check, even yours, is never in the mail. Data are plural. And by the way, where are your damn data? Credibility of a consultant correlates positively with the number of miles flown to get to the client. There are three billable days in any 24-hour period. Get off the computer, get some sun, roll in the hay, drink some fine wine. You and everyone else will feel better. Thank you.
I wrote a presentation. It was organized just right. I rehearsed it all and timed it out. I stayed up half the night. I had a working model of the gizmo there to show. Had everything in order, was all set to go. Then the power went out. The entire world shut down. I couldn't see a single thing in any part of town. The power went out, so I just shriek and moan. Why the hell did I ever leave my flip chart at home? I had a fancy laptop and projection system too, an overhead projector and a video to view. A computer simulation was made specially for me, with hookup to the mainframe back in Memphis, Tennessee. But the power went out. The entire world shut down. I couldn't see a single thing in any part of town. The power went out, so I just shriek and moan. Why the hell did I ever leave that flip chart at home? So there are 2 points here. Keep media as simple as you can, and always, always, always have a plan B. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Bob Mager. No. You work hard on your presentations, and you want them to be a hit, as well you should. One surefire way to ensure the success and the memorability of your presentations is to be so well prepared and so well timed that you finish, shut up, and sit down before people expect you to. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Pierre Maurier. Because my name is spelled this way, my presentation falls between Mager and Murray, so I'm just gonna run away right now. Having said that, though, I'm here to talk about flexibility charts. Very easy. Indicate employees up the top, the skills that they are required to perform either in the existing environment or in a new environment, and make a determination of how well are they able to do the job, are they fully competent, can they do it with training, or can they not do it. This will enable you to identify strategic risks. For example, here's only one person who can do the job. None of them can do it with training. Here's, for example, a whole bunch of people who can do it with training. Would that be a training opportunity? And how about this person here who cannot do anything? This is really easy to read, so you'll see it in the handouts, which are not included in the packet, but available down at the bottom. Purpose of this tool is to do a quick and dirty view of human resource capacity. It can be used to determine training needs, implement organizational change, critical when you're doing process improvement, find out if you have the skills that you need, succession planning, assessing capacities, and so on. And I think, oh, I still have plenty of time. Okay, so let's take a breather. I want to see what this looks like from down here, actually. Okay, managers can use this either in the existing framework or the way it should be. And they rate their employees in each department, as you can see here. And then they find out how to fill the gap. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. I'm Margot Murray, and when I titled this 90-second presentation, Focus Groups for Facts and Fun, I had no idea how much fun we'd have before we got to my session, so hold that thought. Focus groups are well known for their use in market research, and they're also useful, extremely valuable in getting your stakeholders' input and involvement in things like needs assessment and readiness assessment. If you want to involve the client, as was mentioned by a previous speaker, and get their commitment early on, include them in a focus group. They're adaptable. You can make quick changes on your feet, even if you didn't bring your flip charts, Eileen. And it encourages consensus. However, you don't want to use them if you're looking for divergent opinions or for the broader spectrum, and they're easy to summarize. You do have this in your handout, so I'm going to go very fast. How am I doing? Good. In preparing, first of all, clarify the client's problem. Do they want to make a decision, or are they just wanting you to gather information? And then outline the topic questions that you'll use. Then recruit the participants. You're looking for the widest range of diversity, and typically 6 to 10 or 12 people will be sufficient. Arrange the site and the equipment. If you're lucky enough to get a site that has one-way glass and recording equipment, that's very useful, but you'll want a backup of a note taker as well. Prepare the flip charts. What I typically do is put one question or topic at the very top of each flip chart page, and then leave a blank page, and then as you capture the input from the participants, turn the page. Don't keep them posted. You want them to focus on one question at a time. As you facilitate, explain the process. A focus group is not an open discussion. Guide the discussion and make sure you keep them on target and control the participation and yet have the flexibility to go back to earlier questions. And the rest of it you can read.
Hi, I'm Carol Panza. Many organizations continue to be managed the way they are structured, which tends to be functional and vertical. However, there is significant advantage in managing organizations the way they operate, which is horizontal and crosses functional lines. As Gary Rumler likes to say, we need to get control of the white space between the boxes on the organization chart. We also need to begin at the macro level of the organization. If we don't, and define the context up front, and begin at the process level, we run the risk of maximizing for a process or function rather than optimizing for the organization, which should be our goal. This is an example of an organization map which defines the performance context for a whole organization or a part of an organization. And it's also very valuable for identifying improvement opportunities. However, don't stop with an accurate, complete picture, because you can take the same picture and make a far more understandable, user-friendly, and usable impression by considering what I call the art part. And in fact, by simply adding some color, we were able to take a lot of the noise out of the picture and hopefully avoid the possibility that our client would run out of the room screaming, but maybe not. Thank you.
Hi, welcome to Metaphors in Your HPT Life. You do have a handout. I want to talk to you a little bit about what is a metaphor. It is a group of words that you transform into some other image to make a complex concept, many of which we HPTers have, into something simple that your audience can understand. So we're talking about the idea of taking something that is not easy to understand, you working that idea into something that will make it easier to understand, and transferring that to your audience so they can understand the concept. When you use metaphors, there are three good reasons. One is it's very quick to understand. Second of all, it is a very, it's a deeper understanding, especially if you're with a heterogeneous group or with multicultural groups. If you have an image, most people can relate to images. They might not relate to your string of words. And the third is that when you leave, you have an image in your mind. You don't have a string of words to try to remember, and images stay in your memory much longer than a string of words. And I have brought for you today an excellent metaphor of what I mean. This is called a Canton sphere. I have an overhead, just hold on. This is called a Canton sphere. It is a symbol of good luck in China. And it is at least seven concentric circles, all of which have holes in them. But as you may be able to see here, or in the overhead, you cannot see through to the middle. So the complex idea that you're holding in your head has all of these layers, and they're not very clear to the people that you're talking to. So what can you do to make them clearer? You start to think about how to simplify that complex concept into something easier for you. And what you end up doing, if you have a good metaphor, is to translate that into a concept that goes straight to the middle of the sphere, which means that you have hit your audience on target and you've made your point. Thank you.
Oops, can you hear me? Yes. My name is Gloria Regalbuto and I launch corporate universities. And I've often felt that I only had 99 seconds to launch a corporate university. But since I only have 99 seconds to tell you what I've learned over the last something like 14 years launching about nine of these, what I want to tell you are like six unskippable steps in launching corporate universities. And the very first one is to find out what they mean by that. Are they talking about a building? Are they talking about a set of classes? Are they talking about performance technology or performance consulting? Or are they even talking about knowledge management or intellectual capital management? There's a continuum. Find out what it is and give it to them. If they're at the low end of the continuum, work real hard to move them forward later. The second thing, design elements of the university to support the corporate vision, mission, and strategy, and don't stray from that. There's no point in doing anything else. The third thing is to use a two-pronged strategy because you have to get results fast. So you need a quick start and you need a long term. And the quick start is steal, make, buy, convert, work with what you've got to deliver something speedily. And the other one is to analyze what's needed, change performance on a long-term basis, but do both simultaneously. The fourth thing is to clone yourself. There's never enough labor, so take the existing labor you have available and make or buy performance consultants, and that's the easiest thing to do to get moving more quickly. The fifth thing is something way back when I was working at Anchor Hacking, a glass maker taught me, which was, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Pick the programs, interventions, strategies which are functioning and have a lot of credibility and build on them. Use them. They'll give you another quick start. The last thing is deliver and measure. And deliver really means, in any corporation, what you've done for me lately is all that counts. So do it, whatever it is. Measure it. If it isn't working, believe in continuous improvement and fix on the fly, change the tire at 55 miles an hour, do what you have to do to get it working. The last thing I want to tell you is not an unskippable step. It's something you have to remember. It takes about 2.5 years to do this. Be patient with yourself and with them because you need it. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ray Robertson, and I invented performance analysis. Together with my business partner, Al Gore, who invented the internet. You know, this society has been instrumental in shifting the focus from training as the prevalent answer for performance problems to tailored solutions like job redesign, performance support, incentive systems, and many other interventions, of which training is one. That shift in focus has sparked the development of a fundamental tool of our profession, performance analysis. Among the mental models that are available to us, I'm especially fond of these four boxes. They're often referred to collectively as the bridge matrix because they form a simple but effective bridge from appraising a problem on one side to firming up a solution on the other. They remind us that we cannot offer convincing solutions to clients' perceived performance problems until we first impartially analyze the situation, identifying the discrepancies between what is and what should be, determine the probable causes of that discrepancy, diagnose the problem by setting standards that highlight the gap between actual and desired, and finally synthesize, that is, combine the elements into a whole to show the patterns and relationships that suggest solutions that target importance, value, and improvement. I think performance analysis is the gateway to that set of skills that we encourage the world to recognize as the profession of the performance technologist. Getting that that recognition depends on us. Thank you.
Testing. Good afternoon, I'm Daryl Sink, and what I'd like to do today is share with you a tool for helping you to sort through all these wonderful ideas that you're hearing about up here. We use it a lot with brainstorming and things like that tool in our own organization. We come back from a conference or a workshop, we say, what are we going to do with all these ideas? So here's how it goes. First of all, you've got to list the ideas. And Kevin Eikenberry mentioned this as part of his strategy for you here at the conference, along with building a plan for yourself, is to capture those ideas. Okay, now that you have the ideas, what do, though? Well, we suggest that you take each idea and subject it to these four criteria. Is it achievable? That is it practical, straightforward? You'll be able to actually implement it when you get back home. Second, beneficial. That is, does its value outweigh its cost? And third, compatibility. Will it fit into your organization, or will it take an enormous amount of energy to put this into place? And divisible, is it something that can be implemented in parts or in phases? If so, that's, all of these will help that change or idea to take place. So you first look at each idea and apply these four criteria. The ones that score high, then, what we'd like you to do is consider then taking those and rank ordering them. So that's our last one. Oops. So we need to prioritize our ideas, rank order them. And the reason for this is it is awfully hard to implement new ideas of some stature or substance. And so narrowing it down to just one or two that you can go back and make a very careful implementation plan and follow through on, and you'll get a lot more, I think, out of all of those wonderful ideas you're going to be hearing the rest of this week and are hearing in this presentation. Thank you.
Rob Fauché, I'd like to explode a myth that you may have. Learning styles are something that sound like they ought to exist. After all, we've all taught classes. Some people get it, some people don't. There must be a reason other than the fact that maybe we're good at it, maybe we're not. But the reality, unfortunately, is that it ain't that simple. There is no consistent definition of what a learning style is. We can't really decide on who's got which learning style in any really good way. We don't really know what to do if we, in response to a learning style, and there's some substantial question as to whether or not it really makes a difference. There are published so far something over 40 different models of learning styles. No consensus on what a learning style is. The measures are generally of very low quality. They tend not to measure anything that's unique in a statistical sense. They tend to measure lots of times, unfortunately, just intelligence. Another question is, what should we do in response? Well, ideally, you'd want something, some kind of an interaction like that, where it would make a difference. But if you look at the recommendations that come in learning styles, lots of times they say, try a little bit of everything for everybody. Well, heck, if you're going to do that, then why bother? And finally, does it make a difference? Well, there's lots of tantalizing preliminary evidence out there in the literature, but large-scale studies, when they are attempted, typically wind up with very inconclusive results. And that's not a new finding. That's been true in every review of research that's been done on this. Starting in 1977, I read the most recent one like this having to do with reading about a month ago. So I would argue it's a homeopathic fallacy.
Okay, how many of you work with subject matter experts to help them build training programs that are effective? A few of you? Yeah. Tell me, are subject matter experts more focused on content or on learners? How many say content? Learners. Would you like to have something that can help your SMEs transform that dreaded telling info dump into wonderful, effective, learner-centered, performance-based training? Yes, because at the end of this session, that's what you're going to be able to do. And you'll be able to name the 5 steps that transform telling into training. The first thing, get your SMEs to give a reason why the learners should learn. Sounds simple, but the research tells us that that's effective. So we need a... Thank you. Next, make sure that they clearly state the what they will be able to do as a result of learning. In other words, state the... Good. Third, rather than talking a lot, you need to get learners engaged immediately in...
Activity.
Again?
Activity.
Good. I just want you to be active. And make sure along the way that we verify that they've learned by creating... If they get it right, if they have a problem, we need to give feedback. What kind? And if they get it right? So, to summarize, there are 5 steps for getting the SME to convert telling to training. The first step is? Provide a rationale. Next? Clear objectives. Third? Engaging and meaningful. Then? In terms of the objective, and if there's an error? And if they get it right, I confirm.
How did you like my previous approach and appearance as a guru? I want to share a little bit of my autobiography. In 1967, I came to the United States. When I went to get my visa, the council officer said, whatever you do, don't trust New York cab drivers. And I went and bought my ticket at Swiss Air. They said, you got to transfer from JFK to LaGuardia. Whatever you do, don't trust New York cab drivers. I got down at JFK with a little baby and my wife. And when we got out, a cabbie grabbed my luggage and said, get inside. So I said, how much is it going to cost? He said, don't worry, get inside. Sat in the cab, and he started talking. I said, should he not turn the meter on? He said, don't worry. And he went round and round, and I was sure I'm going to be abducted. He kept talking, and he said, tell you what, can we stop by my apartment because my wife has never seen a sari-clad person. She would like to meet your wife. And so he took me around, and I was sure he was going to charge a lot. When we came to LaGuardia, I said with trepidation, how much do I owe you? He said, no charge. Welcome to the United States. 2 learning points. Number one, don't trust the natives to tell you about what's happening in their culture. Second point, when you want to drive home, a key learning point, tell a story. Forget about web-based learning.
Amen.
A few years ago, I was in a cabin up in the Sierras. And I woke up in the morning, and I was cold. I defined a need. Well, I knew what results I wanted. I wanted to get warm. So the question is, what could I do about it? The next question. There are a couple of alternatives. I could go down to Starbucks, get in the car, and go down to Starbucks and have a cup of coffee. Or I could go out and build a fire. I was a good Boy Scout, so I knew how to do it. So I decided to build a fire. And then I did it. These 4 levels of purpose-driven, 5 levels of purpose-driven behavior been extremely useful to us in a variety of kinds of analytical situations. We found many, many uses for it. For example, one use for it is in the area of delegation. If you've got a brand new employee, you may have to sit down with him. You have to specify the need, the result you want, tell him what to do, how to do it, and he does it. Now, if you've got a little more mature employee, all you have to do is specify the need, identify the need, specify the results, what to do. He knows how to do it. Get out of his way. Let him do it. Again, a more sophisticated, all we have to do is specify, identify the needs, specify the results. They knew what, how, and do it. And if it's a level 4, even sit down and talk about negotiating the results. Now, We do this, and we use this same model for looking at delegation. You do not have to go to a 4-day course on situational leadership now to handle differences of levels of maturity and this kind of thing. One of the other interesting things about it is we find some managers always delegate at level one, okay? No matter how competent their people are. When you get below specifying results with competent people, you are micromanaging. So keep that in mind. Keep the little model in hand. It's very useful.
Good evening. My name is Guy Wallace. I'd like to talk with you about something we call performance modeling. There's two parts to performance modeling. One is to chunk out what we call areas of performance or segments or major duties, key results areas, et cetera, et cetera. You can use many different ways of chunking this out. Sometimes it's quite arbitrary. It could be chunked out a different way, and it really doesn't matter as long as you capture the totality of the performance and minimize gaps and overlaps between your chunks, these areas of performance. This is an example for the most convenient store manager based on some actual work. When you take one of those chunks, then, you can do this performance model, which contains two parts. On the left-hand side is ideal performance, the first three major sets of columns, the key outputs and measures, the key tasks, the roles and responsibilities. You simply ask questions, in this area of performance, what do you produce? What are the outputs? How do you know when you're done? How do you measure it? How would you know a good one from a bad one? What tasks do you do to produce that output? That's where our task analysis goes. And then to clarify roles and responsibilities, you can articulate in a collaborative environment, who's doing what? If it's a single performer, then you can skip those roles because it's just one job. The right-hand side constitutes a gap analysis against that ideal performance. And I often look at the measures for an output and ask, typically, are we not getting outputs that meet those measures and standards if we can find them? If I find what those performance gaps are, if I'm really looking for qualified employees and I'm getting poor choices made and unqualified candidates, however the master performers or subject matter expert articulate that, you can then do probable gap causes, or if you have a lot of time, you can do root cause analysis and make darn sure you're really getting to the root. But if you're dealing with master performers who bail out other performers, often they know what the causes are, and then you contribute those causes back to deficiency of environment, deficiency of knowledge and skills of the performer, or deficiencies of their individual attributes and values. Thank you.
I want to thank Ellen and the rest of the ISBA staff for putting this thing together. I want to thank Roger Addison, my co-conspirator. I want to thank all of the wonderful presenters, and most importantly, I want to thank all of you for making this a successful session. That's all, folks. Thank you very much.